Hello all, welcome to GetintoIAS, and in this video, we are going to deal with the prelims questions of 2019 related to environment. So the first question states that in India, extended producer responsibility was introduced as an important feature in which of the following? They have given four options. The first one is the biomedical waste rules 1998. Second one, the recycled plastic rules 1999. Third one, the e-waste rules 2011. And the fourth one, the food safety and standard regulation 2011. So if you note all these points, first of all, you should know what is an extended producer responsibility. Accordingly, the producers who produced all the e-waste, that is the producers who all produce the electronics. So they have the responsibility for the disposal of these waste used by the consumer. So there are producers who are producing stuff, that is the electronic stuff, they sell it to the consumer, and after the consumer has used after certain years, they have the responsibility, that is the producer has the responsibility for the disposal of that waste. So the extended producer responsibility is relating to the option C, the e-waste management and handling rules of 2011. Even the extended producer responsibility is seen in the plastic waste management rules of 2016. So the e-waste and plastic waste management rules of 2011 and 16 has the extended producer responsibility. Next question. Consider the following statements. The first one, the Environment Protection Act of 1986 empowers the Government of India to, the first option, state the requirement of public participation in the process of environmental protection and the procedure and manner in which it is sought. Second one, lay down the standards for emission or discharge of environmental pollutants from various sources. So they are asking which of the following statement is correct. So they've given four options relatively. So if you see the first option, they are telling it states the requirement of public participation. Very important point to be noted down, public participation. Does the Environmental Protection Act of 1986 enlist about the word public participation? Definitely no. The public participation has come down in the environmental impact assessment, which we have already dealt with in our videos. So the first option is wrong because public participation in the process of environmental protection and the procedure and the manner in which they sought is wrong because it doesn't come in Environment Protection Act. It comes in the environmental impact assessment. Next, second one, it lays down the standards for emission or discharge of environmental pollution from various sources. For example, if there is an industry over there, it lays the standards for the amount of emission that is coming out of the industry. So the second option is correct. So option B, 2 only is the correct answer. Next question, as per the Solid Waste Management Rules 2016 in India, which one of the following statement is correct? So what is Solid Waste Management Rules 2016? The first option tells waste generator has to segregate waste into 5 categories. So does the waste generation, we are producing waste, right? So are we segregating that into 5 categories? No, there are only totally 3 categories, the wet, dry waste and the hazardous waste. So only 3 categories, wet waste, dry waste and the hazardous waste, and not 5 categories. So option 1 goes wrong. Second one, the rules are applicable to be notified under urban local bodies, notified towns and all industrial townships only. So you have the extreme word called as only. So it is not only, this solid waste management rules is present in all places and not only in urban local bodies or rural areas. It is present in all areas. So option B is wrong. Coming to the third option, the rules provide for exact and elaborate criteria for the identification of sites for landfills and waste processing facilities. That is, the landfills are the places where you go dump in all your waste. And then after dumping in all your waste inside the landfills, you should take that for processing. So this is given elaborately in the Solid Waste Management Rules of 2016. So option C is correct. Why D is not correct is, it is mandatory on the part of waste generator that the waste generated in one district cannot be moved to another district. No, the waste can be moved from one district to another district. So option D is wrong. So option C is the correct answer according to the Solid Waste Management Rules 2016. And next one, consider the following statements. First one, agriculture soils release nitrogen oxides into environment. So we already saw about the nitrogen cycle, right? So definitely agriculture soils will release nitrogen oxides. Second statement, cattle releases ammonia into environment. Is it right? Definitely cattle will release environment from its waste material that it produces in its feces. And then third one, the poultry industry releases reactive nitrogen components into the environment. So this option is also correct because the poultry releases reactive nitrogen. That is the nitrogen which is coming out of the poultry reacts with other gases present in the atmosphere. So it is reactive nitrogen. So all the three options are correct in this question. Moving to the next question. In the context of proposal to the use of hydrogen enriched, that is HCNG, hydrogen enriched CNG gases or fuel for buses in public transport, consider the following statement. So CNG is compressed natural gas. H stands for hydrogen enriched compressed natural gas. So we have two types of gases, that is the plain compressed natural gas, and now we have the hydrogen compressed natural gas. The first option is the main advantage of the use of hydrogen compressed natural gas is the elimination of carbon monoxide emissions. So normally from a fuel, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, everything will be released. But then this option states when you use HCNG, it eliminates carbon monoxide emission. Does it eliminate or does it reduces? So the first option is wrong because it doesn't eliminate. It just reduces the carbon monoxide emission from 70 to 75% and it does not eliminate. It only reduces. Second option, HCNG as fuel reduces carbon dioxide and hydrocarbon emissions. So this option is correct because the term reduces is coming. It reduces carbon dioxide, it reduces carbon monoxide, it reduces hydrocarbon emissions. Third one, hydrogen up to 1/5 by volume can be blended with CNG as fuel for buses. So recently there was a notification that is the hydrogen can be blended with CNG up to 1/5 of this level and that fuel can be used as a fuel for the buses. So this is how HCNG came. And the fourth option is hydrogen CNG makes the fuel less expensive than CNG. Is it right? No. It is slightly more expensive than CNG. So when you compare HCNG with a normal CNG, this HCNG is little more expensive, that is 5 rupees expensive than the CNG. So the option 4 also is wrong. So when you eliminate option 4, you get option B, that is option 2 and option 3 are the correct answers. That is B is the correct answer. Next one, recently there was a growing awareness in our country about the importance of Himalayan nettle because it is found to be sustainable source of what? A. Anti-malarial drug, B. Biodiesel, C. Pulp for paper industry, D. Textile fiber. So the correct answer for this is Himalayan nettle is used as a textile fiber. So this tree, right, it is found in Uttarakhand, Himachal and Jammu and Kashmir in the north. And mainly it is used for making shawls and suits. So that's why it is used as a textile fiber. Next one, consider the following statement. Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Odisha. Four states have been given. So with reference to the states mentioned above, in terms of percentage of forest cover to the total area of the state, which one of the following is the correct ascending order? So they are asking for the correct ascending order. Ascending order is from small to big. But note the point very well, they are asking the percentage of forest cover to the total area. So you have to take the total area in consideration and you have to take the forest cover also. So the area has to be taken and the forest cover also has to be taken. So accordingly, if you take Maharashtra first, that is from small to big, right? The Maharashtra has less forest cover. So first comes Maharashtra, second comes Madhya Pradesh, third comes Odisha and the last comes Chhattisgarh. So logically applying your brains, you should know that Chhattisgarh is still a tribal area. That is, most of the parts in Chhattisgarh has tribal areas and tribal areas are protected areas. And hence, definitely the forest cover over there will be more. That's why Chhattisgarh is high in terms of forest cover and in terms of the area. So the option C is the correct answer. That is Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, lastly comes Chhattisgarh. Next question. Which of the following statements are correct about the deposits of methane hydrate? So where is this deposit of methane hydrate? They are found in the permafrost. Why is this in news? Because due to the global warming, the ice is melting. And hence, this methane hydrate is found deep inside the ocean water in the North and South Pole. And hence, when the water is melting, this what will happen is it will result in the outflow of this methane hydrate. So it is a poisonous gas, not good for health. And then accordingly, they asked three statements. First one, global warming might trigger the release of methane gas from these deposits. Just now we saw, due to global warming, that is the heating up of the atmosphere, the ice caps and glaciers and all the ice in the oceans is getting melted, and hence this methane from which is stored below and or under is coming out. So the first option is definitely right. Second one, large deposits of methane hydrate are found in Arctic tundra and under the seafloor. Definitely correct. Just now we saw that it's found in the Arctic and the Antarctic region and under the seafloor, and it is found in the mangroves also. What is found in the mangroves? Methane hydrate. And third one, methane in atmosphere oxidizes to carbon dioxide after a decade or two. That is, methane in the atmosphere. What will happen is, after 10 years or 20 years, this methane will oxidize back to carbon dioxide. So this is the process happening. So definitely option 3 is also right. So 1, 2 and 3. Option D is the correct answer. Moving to the next question. Consider the following. Carbon monoxide, methane, ozone and sulfur dioxide. Which of the above are released into the atmosphere due to burning of crop biomass residue? This has been in news for a very long period of time. That is the stubble burning. So since you're burning the crop, right, it releases huge amount of gases into the atmosphere and forms a condition called as smog. So Delhi has been in news due to the poor air quality. So what and all does it release when you burn the crop residue, that is the leftovers after the harvesting? First one, it produces carbon monoxide. Definitely true. It produces carbon dioxide also. Second one, methane. Methane is also let out. And the third one, ozone, is also correct. So due to the photochemical smog that is present in the lower part of the atmosphere, that is the troposphere, called as PAN. Fourth one, sulfur dioxide. So sulfur dioxide is also released due to the burning of crop residue. So all these gases are released due to burning of crop residue. So option D is the correct answer. Next one, in India, the use of carbofuran, methyl parathion, forate and triazophos is viewed with apprehension. These chemicals are used as what? So all these are chemicals. They are asking, in what are these chemicals used? First one, pesticides in agriculture, preservatives in processed foods. Third one, fruit ripening agents. Fourth one, moisturizing agents in cosmetics. So all these chemicals were in use because they are banned or phased out, or it should be reviewed. That is, some chemicals should not be used for the plant because we are intaking the plants and our health gets adversely affected. And hence, some pesticides are banned from using in India. So accordingly, these were in news. That is, the carbofuran, methyl parathion, forate and triazophos were in news because they are used as pesticides in agriculture. Next question. Under the Ramsar Convention, it is mandatory on the part of government of India to protect and conserve all the wetlands in the territory of India. So, is it mandatory? So, we are a signatory to the Ramsar Convention. But is it mandatory to apply all the rules and regulations in India? No, it is not legally binding. Some conventions are not legally binding. The Ramsar Convention is also not legally binding. So, it is not mandatory to apply everything in India. Second one, the Wetland Conservation Management Rules of 2010 were framed by the Government of India based on the recommendations of Ramsar Convention. Definitely right, because we framed the Wetland Conservation and Management Rules of 2010 on the recommendation of the Ramsar Convention. Third one, the Wetland Conservation Management Rules of 2010, same thing, also encompass the drainage area or the catchment area of the wetlands as determined by the authority. So they encompassed the drainage area or the catchment regions as accordingly to the convention. So option B, 2 and 3 is the right answer. Next one, consider the following statements. First one, Asiatic lion is naturally found in India only. Second one, double humped camel is naturally found in India only. Third one, one-horned rhinoceros is naturally found in India only. First, when you see the Asiatic lion, it is naturally found in India only. Yes, Asiatic lion is very famous in the Gir forest of Gujarat. So, it is found in India only. Second one, double humped camel is naturally found in India only. Is it naturally found in India only? No. This double humped camel is found in Afghanistan, Mongolia and even in China. That is most of the Central Asian part. Coming to the third one, one horned rhinoceros is naturally found in India only. Is it found only in India? No. It is found in Nepal, Bhutan and even in Pakistan. So option A, one only is the correct answer. Coming to the next question, in the context of which of the following do some scientists suggest the use of cirrus cloud thinning technique and the injection of sulfate aerosols in the stratosphere? So stratosphere is the area where you have the ozone layer. So this ozone layer acts as a protection layer from the UV radiation. But what is happening now? Due to the thinning of the ozone layer, more amount of UV radiation are entering inside. So what are the measures that a scientist gave us? First one is the cirrus cloud thinning. So when the cirrus cloud is found mostly in the stratospheric region. So what is happening is, when you thin the cirrus layer, it will reflect back most of the UV radiation. So that is one kind of a technique. So the sulfate aerosol, right? So when you spray the sulfate aerosol on the stratospheric region, that has the capacity to reflect the UV radiation. So these are the two suggestions the scientists gave us. So accordingly, what is the answer for this question is option D, reduction of global warming. Next one, in the context of which one of the following are the terms pyrolysis and plasma gasification mentioned? Option A, extraction of rare earth elements. Option B, natural gas extraction techniques. Option C, hydrogen fuel based automobiles. Option D, waste to energy technologies. So what is happening is, many steps is being taken by India to convert the waste to energy. But we are using the old technique again and again, that is the incineration process. With the help of oxygen, you burn all the waste material. But now they have suggested the pyrolysis method and the plasma gasification, which we have already dealt with in our videos. That is, these two methods are effectively used methods. So it is option D, waste to energy technologies. So these technologies convert the waste to energy. That is, we can produce electricity from these methods. Next one, which of the following are in the Agastyamala Biosphere Reserve? So if you note down all the options, in the Agastyamala Biosphere Reserve, one of the 18 biosphere reserves, option A, Nayar, Pepara, Shenduri Wildlife Sanctuaries and Kalakad Mudinturai Tiger Reserve comes under the area of Agastyamala Biosphere Reserve. Next one, consider the following statements. Some species of turtles are herbivores. Some species of fish are herbivores. Some species of marine animals are herbivores. Some species of snakes are viviparous. So you definitely know some species of turtles are herbivores because of the green sea turtle. They are herbivores. Second one, some species of fish are herbivores. That is also true. Third one, some species of marine mammals are herbivores. For example, the dugong or the sea cow is a marine mammal. That is also herbivore. Fourth one, some species of snakes are viviparous. That is, they give birth to the young ones instead of laying eggs. So, all the options are correct. Next question. Wildlife is given in the left side and naturally found in which area? Blue-finned mashir, Kaveri River, Irrawaddy Dolphin, Chambal River, Rusty Spotted Cat, Eastern Ghats. They are asking which pair is correctly matched. So if you don't know the other two also, when you see the option 2, Irrawaddy Dolphins. Irrawaddy Dolphins are naturally found in near the Odisha part. So Chambal River is this side, Odisha is this side. So definitely option 2 is wrong because Irrawaddy Dolphins are oceanic dolphins and not river dolphins. And they need an estuary ecosystem to live in. So when you eliminate option 2, you are definitely left with option 1 and 3. That is the bluefin mashir, which is found in the Kaveri River, and the rusty spotted cat, which is found in the Eastern Ghats. Moving to the next question, why is there a great concern about the microbeads that are released into the environment? So these microbeads are related to the marine ecosystem or the ocean ecosystem. These are microplastic which has entered the food chain. So this is a serious concern, that is, these microplastics has entered into the oceans, and specifically not only these microplastics, the Pacific patch, that is a huge amount of plastic material, is dumped into the world's largest ocean, that is the Pacific Ocean. So relatingly, if you read all the options given below, the option A, they are considered harmful to marine ecosystem because the food chain in the marine ecosystem is being affected. So we're done with the 2019 questions. Thank you.